down our coffee in the lobby. We watch our worship on the screen. We got a rock star preacher who won't wake us from our dreams. We want our blessings in our pocket. We keep our missions overseas. For the hurting in our city, would we even cross the street? But we want to see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see the change in the world out there, it's got to start right here. It's got to start right here.
Am I on now? Okay. Good evening. Welcome to our Tuesday night Bible study. I'm glad that you have joined us. at least for us. I don't know for you. It's pretty snowy and icy out. So hopefully everybody is staying warm. But the one nice thing about having a virtual digital Bible study is that the weather shouldn't prevent us from having Bible study, so I'm sort of excited about that part. The drive in was a little iffy and a little icy, but we made it just fine. Both Scott and I have all-wheel drive vehicles, so we shouldn't have too much trouble getting in typically. Tonight we're in Matthew chapter 3. I just wanted to talk for a minute about where I plan on going. So, you know, we did the Sermon on the Mount, chapters 5 to 8, and then we came back and we did chapters 1 and 2, and now we're going to do 3 and 4. I know that's a little bit confusing, but we wanted to sort of put the Christmas part of Matthew around Christmas. So we did that, and now we're going to go into 3 and 4, and as we continue to work our way through Matthew, one of the things that I was talking to Scott about a while back, he had mentioned he had never read all the way through the Bible. And I think this is okay for me to say. He won't get mad at me, but he mentions that he doesn't have a real solid grasp of the Old Testament. And I had, when I was at Monroe First Church of God, we had a Bible that was chronological in nature, and it's written in the NIV, and it's nice because it leads you through the Bible in a chronological order. And when you get done with it at the end of the year, you're all the way through and have read the Bible. And so I have considered, and maybe you're watching this live or archive, I have considered perhaps at some point starting that in the Bible study. I don't know when we finish Matthew or if we'll break off at some point, but if you have or would like to read the Bible chronologically, so the difference between reading the Bible in the order that it's in and chronologically is that you're going to have a timeline that makes a little bit more sense. And it's really interesting when you start reading the New Testament how like the epistles fit into Acts and everything else. And so if that would be of something of interest, if you would, I'm going to mention it over the next couple of weeks. We'd have to buy the books. I think I've seen them as cheap as less than $10, $10 or $15. But if that's something that you would be interested in, maybe starting in February or March, if you'll put your comments in the field saying, hey, I think that's a good idea, then maybe we could work toward that. And then we would use, what I would do then is you would have a week's worth of reading, once a day readings. And then on Tuesday nights, I would, in this time, sort of pick out something I thought was important in that week's reading. And then on top of that, when we got to the Zoom meeting, any questions you had from your reading, we would discuss. So if that's something that sounds interesting to you, if it's something that perhaps would, perhaps you've never read the Bible completely through, perhaps you would like to read it chronologically, if you'll sort of indicate that in the comments field, we'll start to work toward maybe that as a possibility going forward. So I just wanted to mention that. The other thing, because I'll forget it at the end as I'm rushing to get to the Zoom meeting, Just in case you're trying to fast the same day that I am, tomorrow, which is our prayer meeting night, I will be fasting all day tomorrow. I'm not suggesting that you have to fast on food. You can fast on whatever you want. Maybe after the holidays, fasting on food wouldn't be the worst thing in the world. But fasting is not dieting, and so you shouldn't use it that way. What you should use fasting for, and what I'm asking you to use fasting for, is this: that when you fast from something, when it pops up in your mind over and over again, like, well, I'd like to have a cheeseburger right now, but I can't because I'm fasting, that you will then remember to go to prayer again. And so fasting by itself is one thing. Fasting with prayer becomes powerful. And again, we use the same verse over and over again. Jesus said some things can only be prayed for and be effectively prayed for if we fast and pray. And so what I have called over the last couple months is that I would fast at the end of each month. This month will be tomorrow, which will be December 30th. And I hope that you'll join me in that in some way. If it's not food, maybe it's TV or news or whatever you... It has to be something significant to you. So I just wanted to mention that in case you're wanting to do that with me tomorrow. I hope you try it. People that have tried it so far have said it has been something that has challenged them, but has brought prayer into the forefront of their life for that day, and they have seen effective prayer happening because of it. So Matthew chapter 3, we get outside the birth of Jesus, we get past the nativity scene, and we come to chapter 3 of Matthew, and the precursor to Jesus, the Elijah, the prophet, the announcer of Jesus, was John the Baptist. And you know, remember, and it's recorded elsewhere that John the Baptist, while he was in the womb, meets Jesus and leaps because he realizes the divinity of Jesus, both in the tomb. So we see John the Baptist, and at the end of this chapter, which is only 17 verses, at the end of this chapter, John the Baptist is going to baptize Jesus, and we'll see the significance of that. But we start in verse 1. In those days, and I just want to say one other thing, I'm real phlegmy right now. I don't know why, but I am. So if I call for something, I apologize beforehand. I'll try not to spew anything onto the camera. But I'm a little phlegmy at the moment. So pray for me and bear with me, please. Chapter 3, verse 1. In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Now, the kingdom of heaven is used often in Matthew. Elsewhere in the other Gospels, it's kingdom of God is often used. it is to indicate this kingdom that has come. See, if you have a king, you have to have a kingdom. Here's what's amazing about Matthew. In his record of Jesus Christ, he writes the words kingdom of heaven 25 times. That's a lot. I mean, that's about one time per verse now, or per chapter. Now, some chapters don't have it in it, and other chapters it's just riddled with kingdom of heaven. But it's a significant statement to say that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And I think it can mean a couple things. From what Jesus says, okay, so Jesus gives us all these kingdom of heaven things. He gives us sort of this wide arcing theme, which includes these wonderful promises. The kingdom of heaven is for the poor in spirit on earth, but kingdom bound in heaven. For the persecuted, for those who do and teach the commandments, for those who does the will of God and is offered to all people. One of the places where it says the kingdom of heaven, it says from the east to the west. And so this offer is for all people. Now remember, Matthew is writing to the Israelites. Each gospel has an audience, and in this case, Matthew's is the audience is the Jews or the Israelites, whichever way you want to call them. So when he is saying that it's for all people, what I think he's having to remind them of is, look, Jesus didn't just come for you, those that you think are chosen. He came for everyone. He came for the Gentiles. He came for the, you know, all people. In fact, it, you know, in John it says, you know, for God so loved the world. It didn't say for God so loved the Israelites. It doesn't mean that he doesn't love the Israelites, but this is a more global moment. So he's offered to all people. Interestingly, the kingdom of heaven requires us to go and share the gospel. And people will want it so badly. At one point it says that they will viciously tear down the walls. That they will, like in a concert or something, climb over each other to get to the gospel because it is so desirable. It is so needed. And so it says that the kingdom of heaven, that if we share the gospel, that people will hear it and desire it and want it. Almost in a vicious way, they will come to get it. But it's also mysterious. But also it is knowable. One of the interesting things that Jesus says about the kingdom of heaven is that not only is it a mystery, but that you can know the mystery. It goes on, and this is going throughout Matthew. Later on, when we do more of Matthew, we'll come back and hit some of these as we go on. Then it says that that it's like a mustard seed. It's small at first, but it's going to grow and grow and grow. It's also like a treasure or a beautiful pearl that you would be willing to sell everything you have, give everything away for that treasure. You know, is that the kingdom of heaven to you? Are you willing to give it all for the kingdom? You know, I think often of Zacchaeus and the rich young ruler, and there are points in our lives that we are asked to give it all. Not give it all necessarily financially, but it could be the case. But to give everything that we cling to. Part of the reason that we fast and part of the reason that fasting is so important is that it recognizes those things that we cling to are not important compared to the love of God and to Christ Jesus and of the kingdom of heaven. So when Jesus later talks about the kingdom of heaven, he is saying that it is so valuable that you would give everything away to own it. To have it, to obtain it. And finally, the kingdom of heaven requires humbleness. So really, when he says repent because the kingdom of heaven is at hand, what he's really saying is turn from the devices of the kingdom of man. Now, what are the devices of the kingdom of man? Lies, selfishness, hatred. You know, those are the tools of the kingdom of man. You can just see it in the world today and through history over and over and over again. The kingdom of man is about lying, it's about cheating, it's about self-promotion, it's about hatred. But when we repent of that, we turn back to the kingdom of God, love, peace, and hope abound. You know, often I know many will say that, well, you know, the kingdom of heaven. I mean, I don't understand why you guys get so excited about that. But understand, you know, the kingdom of heaven is in two different timelines. The kingdom of heaven is not only is it that we strive for one day in the future, it can be in this moment. You know, when he says, when John declares the kingdom of heaven is at hand, it is at hand because Jesus Christ is walking the earth. And so there is a now element of the kingdom of heaven. So we can now live in his love. We can now live in his hope. The poor and the persecuted can have hope and peace. We don't have to wait for the future to happen. It can be now. And that's the wonders of the kingdom of heaven. And it is the wonders that John was preaching. And remember, these Israelites were going through, occupation, hatred between each other, hatred between Romans and themselves, hatreds with the Samaritans. They were always warring with each other. And yet, John is preaching this message that the kingdom of heaven is now. Oh, if we would only take that to heart today. The kingdom of earth is done, and the kingdom of heaven is now. Let us rejoice. Let us repent and move back toward the kingdom, is what John the Baptist was preaching. It's interesting, and I didn't give this verse to Scott, but if we went to Matthew 4:17, Jesus says this, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." So what John the Baptist was preaching was what Jesus preached. For him to be the forerunner, that is, John the Baptist is the forerunner to Jesus, the herald to Jesus, that he had to have the same message as Jesus. And so Jesus is preaching the exact same thing, is that the kingdom of heaven is now. Verse 3, "For this is he who was spoken by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." See, many wanted to make John the Baptist John the Messiah. Many lifted him up. And you know, we have that danger today. You know, there are great pastors that try to tamp this down at times, but sometimes encourage it, where they are so lifted up that they're almost like a Messiah themselves. As the church, we always must be careful, and as pastors, we always must be careful that we always diminish and Jesus is always lifted up. If I died tomorrow, I would hope that what you said of me is that, man, he always lifted Jesus up. He always put Jesus in the center of everything. If you said nothing else, it would be the greatest compliment that you ever gave me. It would be the greatest eulogy I could ever have. John was putting Jesus before himself. Oh, if the church would do that more today. And I think in a real sense, we think of angels, right? We think of these wings and all that. But truly, the word angel means messenger. And in many ways, John the Baptist was an angel, a messenger of God, giving out this message, heralding that the Christ had come. Now remember, this is 30 years after the birth of Jesus. So, you know, very quickly we go from, you know, chapter 2, where Herod's trying to kill Jesus and the wise men see him and all that, to 30 years later. So this is one of the things about a chronological Bible that can help sometimes. That 30-year span's a long time. I mean, think about it. There are probably people on this on this Facebook Live tonight that are not even 30 years old or have not been a Christian for 30 years. And so 30 years is a long time. But so when John is heralding Jesus, that the Messiah has come, that the Christ has come, he becomes this messenger of God to get that out. What I find interesting, it says this in Matthew 11:11-12, which I also didn't give to Scott. Assuredly, I say to you, among those born of women, there was not, has not risen one greater than John the Baptist. So Jesus is complimenting John. But hear this. But he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. I take this to mean one thing. That not only was John a messenger of God, an angel of God, that the church, the people that make up the church, are also supposed to be messengers of God, proclaiming the coming of Jesus, proclaiming the greatness of Jesus, proclaiming the glory and the wonders of Jesus. If we all would become Johns, how many people would repent, and how great a revival would we have if we would just see ourselves as messengers? You know, it, in some ways, it's such a joke that the Blues Brothers had to make it out as a funny thing that two guys would be messengers of God. The reality of it is, that's what we're supposed to be. That when we emulate John and we declare that the kingdom of heaven is here now, that the Messiah has come to seek and save the lost, that it is our responsibility to be as much a messenger as John was, and we are as great as John. One of the greatest fallacies, I think, that we ever did in the church is to make John and put him up on a pedestal somewhere and say he's greater than Scott, or he's greater than Tammy, or he's greater than, you know, Kathy, or he's greater than Jeanette. John was no more a saint than you are. John was a messenger of God, and I believe that we are purposefully chosen to be messengers also. You may say, well, you're a pastor, Scott, you're supposed to be a messenger. But the reality of it is that if you want a revival to truly happen, you know, we say all the time, boy, I wish we'd have a revival in this country. You want it to happen? Then you start declaring the kingdom has come. You quit worrying about what people think. And you start worrying about how important it is that they hear the message of God. That you are willing to give up whatever it takes so that one more person will find Jesus. In 4 it says, now John himself was clothed in camel hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Just to say this, we could go in great depth of what this means. You know, I mean, his Nazarite part upbringing, his beliefs there. But I just wanted to sort of draw it out just in this way for tonight. We don't need to get that deep in this scripture. John was dressed as a poor, simple man. He had no resources or tools. And yet he was willing to be a messenger of God. God is not asking you to be a superhero. He's asking you to be willing. And if you're willing, God will use you like John the Baptist. He may only use you for one person, but what if that one person no longer is heading down the path of hell, but instead is living in the joy and the peace and the hope and the love of the kingdom of heaven? Then Jerusalem, all Judea, all the region around Jordan went out to him and were baptized by him in the Jordan, confessing their sins. See, a revival happens when a messenger of God is willing to speak the truth of Jesus. Who came? Everyone. It says all people came. And it describes that whole region was on fire for God. And when I say all people, you know, I talk often about outsiders. You know, Christianity is not about the privileged. It is about Jesus saying that we all are worthy. And for the first time for many of these outsiders, like the poor and the persecuted, the women, the children, the lepers, the tax collectors, the Samaritans, anybody that was unworthy of temple worship, all at once saw the Christ and saw their salvation. I mean, one of the most powerful chapters of the Bible, John chapter 4, the Samaritan woman was an outsider and would have told you she was not worthy to have the conversation she was having with Jesus, and yet Jesus had come to save and seek the lost. And John came as a messenger declaring that was a possibility. It goes on in 7, but when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to the baptism, he said to them, brood of vipers. One of these times I'm going to preach, and that's the first words that are going to come out of my mouth. You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? See, John is like, wow, they're here. He sees these religious, pompous, judgmental people coming. He can't believe it. But that's how powerful the message is. It breaks down barriers that allows people to come. Look, you know, Jesus is really tough on the Pharisees and the Sadducees. But the reality of it is, some of the first Christians were Pharisees and Sadducees. Some of the first Christians broke away from this religious, judgmental way that, you understand, like a Pharisee would walk around and look at you like, you're a sinner, you're a sinner, you're a sinner, I'm better than you. And the Sadducees, they're a whole different group, and they didn't even believe in eternal life or anything. But I think John's just amazed that they're there. For us, I think it's important as churches today that we're less about religion and we're more about Jesus. Now, you may say, well, religion and Jesus is the same thing. What I mean by that is that we're less about, you know, having liturgical ways that we do things. There's nothing sinful about them until the point that they exclude Jesus. One of the things that a church must always ask themselves is that, why do we do this? Whatever we're doing, why are we doing this? And if it is not to be messengers of God, then we should cast it away and throw it away. Our worship service should be about messaging how great God is, how God is there for us. Our prayer time should be a message of that. Everything I do, our videos, our preaching, everything that we do in the church should be pointing to Jesus. If it is not, it is worthless and meaningless. And I think when he sees these people, he's amazed that they are coming and they're pushing aside their thoughts and their preconceived ideas of what it means to worship God. It goes on to say, therefore bear fruits worthy of repentance. He's telling them, if you're going to come, don't just come for the party. Don't just come for the fellowship. You know, you need to bear righteous fruit. You need to be willing to come and allow God to work. Because it says, it goes on to say, and do not think to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father, for I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. So he's saying, look, if you don't want to come, if you don't want to be serious about this, if you don't want to get focused on Jesus, God can create followers out of these stones over here. Jesus, when he's coming in to the for the final week, the Passion Week, they say to Jesus, tell your disciples to pipe down. He said, if I do, the stones will start to praise me. Verse 10, and I am way behind. We could go an hour. I could go an hour. So what I'll probably end up doing is in about 2 or 3 minutes, we'll stop wherever we're at and we'll move to the Zoom and we'll talk about whatever I don't reach in chapter 3. So let's go a couple more verses. 10, and even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree which does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. God's judgment is at hand. When Jesus came, God's judgment was at hand. It wasn't, just that Jesus had come to save, but there was going to be people that rejected him. Those people, the axe was to the tree, the axe was to, and there was going to be judgment. 11, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I'm not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. The only point I wanted to draw out of this is baptism is only a symbolism of salvation. Baptism symbolizes but does not have any spiritual effect that would be the same as what Jesus and the Holy Spirit does in our hearts. And John's pointing that out. I'm baptizing you. It's important that you're baptized. It's symbolic of what's going to happen, but it's not the same as what he is going to do. And then it goes on to say in 12, his winning fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Now, I think that I'm going to close there, and we'll talk about Jesus' baptism in the Zoom meeting. I hope you join us, by the way. All you got to do is, if you go to the newsfeed, you'll find a gray box. If you click on it, it'll lead you there. Chaff, I don't know if you know what chaff is, but it, like, if you're separating the wheat, which there is the heads of the wheat, which is the grain, which is the fruit of the wheat, and then there's this dust and stubble and everything else that is everything else. So when we hear that he's coming with a winnowing fan, that means they blow away the light stuff so that only the fruit is left. I think perhaps one way you could read that is that if you're not bearing fruit, you are chaff. If you're not bearing the fruit of righteousness, the Holy Spirit, you are chaff. In other words, you are dust. You are man-like, because we are made of dust, right? And you're not God-like. And that if we do not bear fruit, he told the Pharisees and Sadducees, bear righteous fruit. If we do not do that, then we're like dust in the wind, and that God will one day deem us take the fruitful people to heaven. That doesn't mean that it's works. What it means is that if you are saved and you are Christ, you are going to be fruitful and multiply. And so that is John's message. Right after that, Jesus is baptized. There's some interesting symbolism in that baptism, and I hope that you'll join us on the Zoom meeting, which will be in about 2 minutes. God bless.